Hello dear classmates, welcome back to the VLSI testing class. In this video, we are going to introduce you many different types of testing. This page shows you a tree of many different types of testing. Starting from the root of the tree, generally speaking, the concept of testing can be classified into design verification, implicit testing, and explicit testing. In this course, we will focus on explicit testing only. We are not going to details of design verification or online testing. Under explicit testing, we have many different types of testing. Please don't be worried about so many different names. You are not required to memorize all the names. In this video, we just want to show you the purpose and the importance of each test. So why do we need so many tests? This is because there are many different types of problems. For example, we can have design errors in the design phase, such as logic design errors, physical design errors, and so on. To detect these design errors, we need design verification. In the manufacturing phase, we can have manufacturing defects, such as mask problem, lithography problem, particle scratch, or bad recipe, and so on. To detect manufacturing defects, we need explicit testing, which is the focus of our course. We will go into details of explicit testing for the rest of this video. During the functional operation, we can have external or environmental disturbance such as electromagnetic interference, alpha particle, power supply disturbance, and so on. To detect this disturbance problem, we will need implicit testing or online testing. Finally, at the end of the lifetime, we can have wear out problems such as electromigration, corrosion. To detect the reliability problem, we will need reliability testing. Because there are so many different types of problems, so we need many different types of testing. In this course, we are going to focus on explicit testing. Explicit testing can be classified according to different standards. First of all, it can be classified according to the purpose of the test. For example, production test is performed for volume production. So the test cost and test quality is very important. On the other hand, characterization test is performed only on a small amount of prototype chip. So test time and test cost are not so important for characterization test. Reliability test is performed to detect reliability defects, and diagnosis test is performed to identify the location of the defects. As we can see, these four tests have different purpose. Also, explicit testing can be classified according to the stage when the testing is performed. For example, wafer test is also known as wafer sort or wafer probe. This is performed on wafer before the IC are packaged. On the other hand, package test is also known as final test, which is performed after the IC are packaged. And system test is performed when the IC is plugged into the system. Finally, explicit testing can be also classified according to test techniques. For example, DC parametric tests measure the DC performance of the IC, such as VOH, BOL, VIH, VIL. These parametrics are not frequency dependent. On the other hand, AC parametric tests measure the speed dependent characteristic, such as rise time, fall time, and operation frequency of the IC. Boolean tests apply test pattern at low speed. This is to detect the DC fault, which are not frequency dependent. On the other hand, delay tests apply test pattern at fast speed to detect delay faults, which are test speed dependent. Functional tests apply design verification patterns to operate the IC in functional mode. IDDQ tests measure the quiescent power supply current of the IC. And finally, low voltage tests the circuit at reduced power supply voltage. All of these tests are applied in different test techniques. Now, we will look into more details about production tests. The purpose of production tests are twofold. First of all, we need to ensure the quality of the IC before selling them to our customers. And second, we want to sort our IC for different specifications. For example, we can sort CPU at different speed so that we can sell them at different price. This figure shows a typical production test flow. After the wafer is manufactured, we perform a wafer test or wafer sort. Then we can repair a defect memory on the die using laser. And then we package those dies that pass the wafer test, and then we will perform a burning. Before the burning, we perform a pre-burning test. After the burning, we perform the post-burning test. We can compare the behavior of the IC before the burning and after the burning. If the behavior of the IC changes significantly, then we strongly suspect this IC has reliability defect. So we had better not to sell it to our customer. And then we perform a final test and we mark the IC according to their speed. Finally, we have a visual inspection and we can sell them to our customer. A small amount of sampled IC will be tested to assure the quality. So this is called a quality assurance test. In production tests, test costs and the test quality are the main driver. So the actual test flow can be modified according to the test cost and test quality requirement of the product. For example, if this is not a very expensive IC, we could choose to skip the burning test because burning is quite expensive. Now it's time for food for thought, FFT. This is a good time to exercise your brain. Since we already have wafer test or wafer sort in the production test flow, why do we need package test or final test again? Is that redundant? Can we save test cost by removing wafer test or final test? This is a good question to think about. You can get the answer in our next video. This picture shows a typical arrangement of a production test floor. On the test floor, there are many testers and the handlers, and the circuit under test are inside the handler. There is a three-color light indicating the test status. A green light represents a pass, a red light represents a fail, and the yellow light indicates that this machine requires technician attention. This picture shows a typical automatic test equipment, or ATE. Sometimes we just call it tester for short. A tester looks just like a mainframe computer with test program running on this ATE. Here is a console for test engineers to develop the test program. And the circuit under test, or CUT, is sitting on the low board on top of the test head. The test head provides electrical signal to the circuit under test via the connection to the low board. This picture shows details of the low board. A low board is a test fixture to interface the automatic test equipment and the circuit under test. On the back side of the low board, we see many contact pads so that this low board can connect to the tester. On the front side, we see a socket, and the CUT can be latched in this socket. In production tests, because there are millions of IC to test, it is impossible to use human labor. So we have handler, which is a robotic arm, to move the packaged IC around according to their test result. We now show you a short clip. The robotic arm moves the packaged IC around according to their test results. We have shown you a typical production test for packaged IC. So how can we test the dies on the wafer? How do we perform wafer test? This picture shows a typical setup for wafer test. On our left hand side, again, is our ATE. On our right hand side, it's a test head. Please note that the test head is now facing downward, and the probe card and the low board is sitting in between the test head and the probe station. There are many wafers stored in the probe station, and each time we test one wafer. So how does the test head connect to the dies on the wafer? The test head connect to the die via a probe card. A probe card is a test fixture to interface the low board and the die. From this picture, we can see that there are many small needles in the middle of a probe card which connect to the die. Because of the signal integrity problem, we cannot probe the die at fast speed. In the design of the probe card, we must carefully balance the inductance and capacitance of each needle. In production tests, we need regular cleaning of the probe card after a specific number of touchdowns. Because the probe card wear out very quickly, so it should be replaced after a number of touchdowns. So why do we call it wafer sort? This is because after the wafer sort, we sort the dice into different bins according to their test result. This figure shows an example of wafer map. On this wafer map, each color represents a test result. For example, the green square represents a die belong to bin number 1. This die passed all the tests. A red color represents bin number 2, which means this die failed functional test, so we cannot sell it to our customer. The yellow color represents a die that passed the functional test, but it failed the IDDQ test. And the blue square represents a die that failed DC parametric test. This wafer map provides us very useful information for pass-fail decision, for diagnosis, and for yield improvement. For example, for this particular wafer, the yield can be defined as the number of bin number 1 die over the number of total die, which is 60%. If you think the above description is pretty boring, you can watch a video clip on YouTube which explains very clearly a production test environment. We now watch a small part of the clip to introduce the wafer probe.
To test a wafer, you need a wafer prober, automatic test equipment, a probe card, and a customized test program. After loading of the test program, the wafer lot is placed in the wafer prober. The prober automatically selects one wafer at a time for testing. The wafer is placed on the truck and held steady with vacuum. An advanced positioning system helps move the truck around in a rapid and very accurate pattern below the probe card in order to test every single device on the wafer. The tester generates a wafer map that shows which devices are good and which are bad. This information is used later in the supply chain when the wafers are being further processed.
You are encouraged to watch the rest of the clip by yourself. Please note that some terminology are different from our lecture. They use wafer prober as probe station. They use component test as package test. And they also show electro anti-static equipment, which prevent the circuit from being damaged by static discharge from a human body. We have finished the production test. Now we move on to the characterization test. Characterization test means that we test a small amount of prototype IC very thoroughly. Because the number of IC tested is very small, test time and the test cost are not big concern for characterization test. This is opposite to production test. The purpose of characterization test includes, first, we want to verify the functionality of the IC is the same as our design. This is also known as silicon debug. If there is anything wrong with the function, we need to redo our design. Second, we want to confirm IC specification under different test conditions. IC specifications can be operation speed, DC parametric such as VOH, VOL, or AC parametric like rise time, fall time. The test conditions can be power supply voltage, VDD, or temperature. Finally, the third purpose of characterization tests is to develop a test program for production tests. We need to determine the pass-fail limit in production test so that we can have an acceptable yield. Schumann plot is a good way to show the result of characterization test. A Schumann plot is a graphical display of characterization test result under different test conditions. This figure shows an example Schumann plot. On the y-axis, it's VDD, the power supply voltage. On the x-axis, it shows the clock period. A green rectangle in this Schumann plot represents a path. On the other hand, a red rectangle represents a fail. As we can see from this Schumann plot, when we drop the power supply voltage, the IC becomes slower and slower. From this Schumann plot, we can see that characterization test is very time consuming. Each rectangle in this Schumann plot represents a test. So to finish this Schumann plot, we need n by m different tests. So it takes a very long time. So why do we call it Schumann plot? This is because the funny shape of the Schumann plot resembles a cartoon character called Schumann. Now let's watch a cartoon clip of Schumann by NBC 1979.
It's the new Schumann, the incredible new Schumann. He's gonna please you. This incredible new Schumann likes you.
Now let's move on to reliability tests. There are two types of reliability tests. The goal of burn-in tests is to screen out infant mortality, which is also known as early life failure. The approach of burn-in tests is to raise the temperature and voltage in the oven. This is like cooking the IC in the oven for hours or even days. As you can see, this is a very costly test. So burning is only applied to expensive IC such as CPU. A second reliability test is accelerated life test. The goal is to estimate the lifetime of the IC. So we burn in the IC in the oven until they are dead. Because the result of accelerated life test are dead IC. So this test is only applied to a small amount of sample IC. This is a famous bathtub curve that shows IC's failure rate over time. Because the shape of this curve resembles a bathtub, so we call it a bathtub curve. The definition of failure rate is equal to the percentage of failures in a period of time. Within 20 weeks after IC manufactured, the failure rate is pretty high. We call this infant mortality period. The failure rate is high because there are some reliability defects that escape our production test. If we want to screen out the weak chip, we need to use burn-in test. After 20 weeks, in normal lifetime period, the failure rate remains low and flat. However, at the end of the life, the IC enters the wear out period, where the failure rate increases again.
If we want to know the exact lifetime of the IC, we need to perform the accelerated life test, or ALT.
Now we have finished the main focus of this course, explicit testing. We will also talk a little bit about design verification and online testing, which are not the focus of this course. We will briefly mention them in this talk only. The purpose of verification is to check if our design correctly implements our specified behavior. From this figure, we can see that starting from the specification, we will have a design either in code or netlist or layout. If we want to see if our design is the same as our specification, we will do a verification. So verification is typically done before manufacture. We want to catch if there is any design errors or bugs. The approach of verification is simulation or formal verification and so on. After we are sure there is no bug in our design, we will send our IC to manufacture, and then we will have a physical device or IC chip or silicon. If we want to make sure the silicon is the same as our design, we will perform explicit testing. So explicit testing check if the IC is functionally correct or defective. Explicit testing is done after manufacture to catch defects. So we apply test pattern on the tester to test our IC chip. From this figure, we can clearly see that explicit testing is not the same as verification. Another concept related to test is implicit testing. The purpose of implicit testing is to check our IC output and see if it is correct during normal operation. Implicit testing is also known as concurrent error detection or online testing. This is done for mission-critical systems such as airplane, satellite, mainframe computers, etc. There are many implicit test techniques. For example, in the circuit level, we can have error correction code ECC protection of our memory. In the system level, we can have a watchdog timer. If you want to know more about implicit testing, please take classes in Fortran system or online testing. In summary, in this video, we have introduced the focus of this course, which is explicit testing. Explicit testing means that we test the IC offline on a specialized tester. Explicit testing is not the same as design verification, and it's not the same as online testing. We have shown many different types of testing for different purposes, stages, and techniques. The reason why we have so many different tests is because we have many different problems. You don't have to memorize all the names. You only need to know why we need this test. And the important concept will be revealed again in the other videos. Thank you for watching.